I mean, we were working at 100 miles an hour for 2 years. It normally takes 1 year from start to finish to do an hour long archival doc, and we did 10 in 2 years. So that first interview has to go well, or else you're really, really up a creek. I'm gonna hunt you down.
Jason, welcome to Why I Made over in Netflix UK. What was the film that you, in your mind's eye, when you sat down with that blank sheet of paper or that blank Google Doc or whatever at the beginning, way back yonder, what was the film that you set out to make?
We set out to humanize these people because I saw them as larger than life. In Michael's case, he's almost mythical. And there's such a mystique surrounding those teams back then because the cameras of today were not as ubiquitous back then as they are now. Now we, you know, players are on social media, in the locker room, in their homes, in their practice facilities. They're showing you how they work out in the off season. There really aren't many hidden spaces. Well, back in the 90s, documentaries like this didn't exist, and we rarely saw our favorite athletes out of uniform off the court or off the field. So before Michael Jordan, there were no arrival shots of players arriving at games. He is the one who created the necessity for that because people were so starved to see him out of the uniform and see what he was actually like, how he navigated the world. So I credit the NBA for having the foresight to document this final season, not knowing what it would ever become, but just having the sense that history was about to be made, win or lose. And I'm glad they did because here we are. Throughout my childhood in the 80s and 90s, the Bulls were the preeminent team on the globe. You just need to look at the first episode of our series. It was like the Beatles going to Paris when they went there. So these guys transcended basketball. They transcended the NBA in the States, and they were global rock stars. So Michael's face, I think at one point, he was one of the most, the three most famous people on the planet. It was Princess Diana, Michael, and the Pope. So when people see that there's going to be a documentary about this guy who once was and still in many respects is one of the most famous people on the planet, then especially now when people are held captive in their homes and they're looking for something new to watch, it makes sense.
There are quite a few kind of heartbeats throughout the series that like emotional kind of touch points. There's like the Father's Day. You've obviously got the amazing kind of episode with Kobe in it. How were you at plotting those through? Were they always part of the plan to kind of hit those beats?
Well, Kobe wasn't, because none of us could have seen what was going to happen.
No, sure. Yeah.
The reason why Kobe's scene is where it is because it happened at the All-Star game, and the backbone, chronologically, the backbone of this story is the 97-98 season. So the midpoint of the season is the All-Star break, and that was always going to be the midpoint of the series. And we actually edited Kobe's scene 2 weeks before he passed away, which is still crazy for me to even say out loud. It just doesn't seem real. But we didn't change a frame of that. The only thing we did was add the dedication at the top of the episode, but we didn't change a frame of what we cut because he had passed away. The story was what it was.
You're a fan saying, hey, Kobe, you beat Michael one-on-one. I feel like, yo, what you get from me is from him. I don't get five championships here without him because he guided me so much and gave me so much great advice.
One of my favorite parts of the entire series happens very soon in episode one, which is when Michael takes the iPad and sees his mom reading a letter home from him, back when he was Mike Jordan and couldn't afford stamps. And this is a man who's worth $2 billion now, watching his mother. And you can see that when he sees her face and hears her voice, it takes him back to a place that he was as a homesick kid in Chapel Hill at 18. And I really wanted that to be towards the front of the series to kind of signal that we're going to tell a story about Michael Jordan and the Bulls as human beings, not as superstars.
And the knock-on effect of having someone like Michael talking about his own life is that you can phone up Barack and say, yeah, we got Michael. Michael says you might want to talk to us. And he goes, yeah, sure. That must, that you know, the doors must have opened pretty quickly.
Well, we interviewed 106 people in this documentary, and a lot of them regularly get phone calls to participate in some sort of Michael Jordan project, whether he's participating or not. And you know, most of the time he's not participating because he doesn't do anything like this. So these people who are affiliated with him either closely or as satellites are used to getting these phone calls and just ignoring them. So what his team did was drafted a letter on behalf of Michael, and I told them who I wanted to speak with, and they sent out this letter before we contacted them. So it said, Jason and his team will be contacting you. Michael will be participating in this. We'd love your participation as well.
Every celebrity booker's dream.
It was a mountain to climb from a booking standpoint. I mean, the most people I've ever interviewed for a documentary is 25, and we had over four times that for this. Wow. And they're scattered throughout the United States or even the globe. You know, when people criticize Michael's involvement in this and his editorial control and all that, it's utter bullshit, because he helped us tell the story in this way. If we didn't have his cooperation, first of all, this wouldn't have happened. There would be no story.
Yeah. I think it's quite naive to expect someone like Michael Jordan to take part in something so personal and for him just to go, yeah, here are the keys, you go with it, you know.
But it also, I mean, he essentially did do that. Don't get the sense that Michael wants to be burdened with watching rough cuts and things like that. This is not a guy.
The cigar and his whiskey going.
I think of all the people, Michael cared the least about the making of this thing, because he's so secure in who he is. He's secure with his legacy. He's satisfied that he has done what he came here to do in a basketball sense. So the idea that he is going over this thing with a fine-tooth comb and saying what we can and can't do, he never said anything about what we couldn't do. Every story that we wanted to tell, we told. And the only thing that his team did was grease the wheels for us to contact the people. You wouldn't have had half of the people in this documentary if we didn't have their assistance in booking these people. Get your camera out, baby, you could take a film. You can see my vision through the clouds when I feel them. State of affairs, your boy about to 1 million. Say hi to the bad guy, cause baby, I'm a villain. Catch me in the fight, Frank Lucas chinchillin'.
Was there anything about the reaction to the show that surprised you, or what you got?
Yeah. The first Michael interview that we did.
I can't imagine how nervous you must have been.
I was extremely nervous. Because, not to meet him, because I had met him before, but just there was so much riding on that first interview. If you don't get a good interview from him, we knew we were going to get two or three. But if the first one doesn't go well, then the dominoes are going to fall and you're going to be behind the eight ball for the rest of your time with him. In addition to that, in addition to diplomatically it having to go well, we had to get a lot of content because my editors were sitting there starving for material and we had nothing to edit with because we had just started this process and it couldn't have gone better. I remember, as I always do, I talked to my family afterwards. I called my dad and he and I have such a bond because, you know, I saw Michael play for the first time with my dad when I was 9 years old. And I called him and I said, it's an A+. It couldn't have gone better. And the people I work with know that I'm very conservative with that. I always see the glass half empty when it comes to what we got, because I'm always killing myself over not getting this detail or that. So they know, my team knows that when I come back and say it was an A+, then it must have been an A+. And that's what we got out of Michael that first time. So that was a moment. I remember we stood around, there was a swimming pool outside of that house in the back. It's right against the ocean. And it was dark by the time he left and by the time we were packing up. And we all, we stood in a circle and all of us put a shot glass up. And I said, we're gonna have the exact same people back here the next time. The makeup artist, the caterer, everybody, the exact same.
Don't jinx it, keep him familiar. Yeah.
Whatever formula, whatever concoction we had stumbled upon was, let's just keep this as identical as possible to this, because all of us agreed that it couldn't have gone any better.
Championship in the last 7 years. What do you think about the end product in comparison to what you set out to make? How close was the idea to what you all ended up with?
It's the closest that I've ever come to achieving the vision that I had at the outset of a project. That's a testament to the characters that we interviewed. We always knew the chronology was going to be the way that we did it, and I know that it's confused some people, but to me, it was pretty simple.
Mate, it's all confusing over in the UK. I've got no idea what's going on in terms of how the seasons are structured. And all, you mentioned the mid-season break, so it was the All Star. As if I got no idea. I'm just enjoying it. I was there for the air.
It was always meant to be two converging timelines. One is the 97-98 season. The other one is when Michael came into the league, going up to 98. So by the time we get to the finals in 98, two timelines have converged, and there's no flashbacks anymore. it's getting people's perspective on a particular moment in time. And this is where I think you can decipher journalism from storytelling, is that, you know, journalism, we have to have, if someone says, you know, I scored 5 points in the first half and Michael had 20, a journalist would be irresponsible if that person said 5 points and they actually scored 7. And they'd say, well, we can't put that in the story. I'm comfortable putting that in the story if it's off by a couple of points, because the essence of the story is that Michael wasted me in that half.
Yeah.
So we're not gonna get egregious with it, and we're not gonna have people misremember results of games and all that. But this is really, it's we had no narrator, and that's a very conscious choice, because narrators tend to be, and they're telling you the facts from their point of view. Well, the characters in the story told the facts from their point of view. We told the story as best we could and as honestly as we could.
Thank you so much, Jason. It's been fantastic chatting to you, and congratulations on one of my most surprising favorite shows of recent years. It's brilliant. And thanks for telling us why you made it.
That's great to hear. And thank you so much for having me, and please be well out there.
Brilliant stuff. Thank you, everybody.
All right, guys. Thanks.
Take care.